topic of today's talk is the Beirut School of Critical Security Studies, Implications on North Africa, by Dr. Samer Aboud, who has very kindly accepted our invitation and came all the way here during his vacation. We are very honored to have you with us. Dr. Samer Aboud is an Associate Professor of Global Interdisciplinary Studies at Villanova University, and he is the coordinator of the Beirut School of Critical Security Studies, working group of the Arab Council of the Social Sciences. Dr. Aboud is the author of Syria, published by Quality in 2018, and co-authored with Benjamin Mueller the book Rethinking Hezbollah, Authority, Legitimacy, Violence. He has published widely on issues of political economy, not an economist,
yes.
but political economy, on security and the contemporary Middle East, including journals such as Security Dialogue, Political Science, Arab Studies, Quarterly, and Middle East Policy. So today's talk will deal with the Beirut School Manifesto, which I adhere to. And Dr. Aboud presented a bit the working group as well, but I'm a bit overexcited, so I just want to tell you to check their full website. So this is www.thebeirutforum.com, in which you can learn more about the forum and also learn about their summer institute, so particularly for students, to enrich your experience of the region. Again, thank you for being with us, and the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. Can everyone, should I speak into the microphone? Okay, thank you. I tend to talk to my feet, so the microphone is a good idea. I would like to thank, of course, to begin by thanking Dr. Zainab Al-Barnoussi for the invitation. The School of Humanities and Social Sciences, the Human Development and Economic Research Unit, and the Arab Council for the Social Sciences, and the coordinator of this project through the ACSS, and they're kind enough to support me being here, even though, as Zainab said, I'm on vacation with my family. I'm lucky enough to be married to a Moroccan, and so we are spending the summer here. And I am on vacation, and I spent the morning at the pool with my three children and my wife, so if I slip into informality, please excuse me. I do have notes that I will try to adhere to, but I will do my best to not get into vacation mode as I'm talking. Usually, you know, my area of interest and expertise is in Syria, as Zainab mentioned, and I have this great joke that I usually begin all my talks on Syria with. I don't have a comparable joke about Morocco or Moroccans or anything like that to start with, so I'll just start with a confession instead of a joke. And the confession is that as the co-coordinator of this Critical Security Studies group, now we're entering our fourth year in October, I'm constantly reflecting on the work that we're doing, whether it's meaningful or not, what our relationship is to other academic fields and so on. And so the confession today is that I'm using this opportunity as a moment of reflection, so I hope you'll bear with me. My task today is to introduce all of you to what we're calling the Beirut School of Critical Security Studies. What the work of the collective that has tried to create this school entails, and what our vision is for the advancement and direction for the study of security and insecurity in the Arab region is. In doing so, I not only want to sketch out the contours of a major research agenda, what we're calling a school, but to also reflect on some of the social and institutional challenges we face in producing knowledge across this vast region that we call the Arab world. The two main challenges I identify here are the current state of academic networks in the social science community in the Arab world, as well as the state of the field of critical security studies itself. It's within the space created by both these challenges that I want to locate our project. So my presentation will begin with a brief discussion of what I see as the state of Arab social science and its relationship to our project, Then I want to move on to what critical security studies is as a field, and then talk about the formation of the Beirut School. I'll conclude with some, and this is the reflection part, of course, with some reflections and questions about what our project means for the study of security and insecurity in North Africa, and why such a project is necessary, needed, in today's geopolitical climate. So, why is this happening now? What are we responding to? What is the context that in which we form this collective? Arab social science research, much like research undertaken in other parts of what we might call the global social science periphery, is heavily influenced by Western norms, theories, and approaches to social science research. While problem-solving approaches do exist, and indeed are present throughout the region, the influence of Western approaches on social science research is very apparent. One of the major challenges of any research project designed in and for the region is in overcoming the positivist and Eurocentric legacy of social science research that saturates much of what is produced in the region today. And much of this is confirmed by the State of Social Sciences report produced by the Arab Council for the Social Sciences, which I would recommend you all, I wish I had copies with me today. Many scholars, we're not the first, of course, but many scholars have identified the Eurocentrism of social sciences and the academic imperialism that this engenders. Such processes have led to generations of knowledge production that produce and reproduce global hierarchies and inequalities, not simply in regards to the source of knowledge production, but the texture, languages, and assumptions of research as well, which are often uncritically imported into the study of social sciences outside of the West. This is not simply a problem of the positionality or geography of the researcher, whether inside or outside of the region, but a fundamental problem of perspective and approach. One's status as an insider, that is, from within the region, does not automatically produce research that is critical of prevailing norms and practices, in much the same way that someone's outsider status does not preclude her or him of producing critical research. This is not to romanticize something local, but just to reflect critically on these kind of insider-outsider dichotomies. Second, issues of language and access have stunted the growth of transnational social science networks. Weak horizontal integration between social science researchers in the region, coupled with the Western dominance of social science that magnetizes conferences, workshops, and major research centers in the West, means that most researchers in the global social science periphery have limited access to social science communities and networks. This problem is aggravated by the limited availability of institutional and government funding for research and conference travel. In addition, many researchers working in Arabic and non-Western languages often have challenges in submitting and revising manuscripts for journals. So at least one example of International Political Sociology, which is a major journal that does critical work in security studies and international relations, they say they accept publications in Arabic, but they've actually never received one. And partly because the process of review is so cumbersome, and then the author has to also facilitate a translation. So they'll take the article, but they won't publish it in Arabic. So there are many barriers, even within critical journals, to publishing this kind of research. So for this and a host of other reasons, social science research, especially into security issues, that emanating from the region is very limited. This is an especially acute problem in the context of critical security studies in and of the region. I don't need to elaborate on the many examples that you see in the news of researchers there's examples from Egypt about people even doing research on unions and things of that sort, and many of the issues that people have in conducting research in the region. In addition to the problems of conducting critical research and writing critically, we have this problem where a lot of, or this issue that the presence of the dominant theories of international relations, whether they're these realist or strategic studies ontologies, like these are often taken as given, and rather than the realities of occupation, war, intervention, proliferating violence, economic insecurity, rather than these conditions producing a critique of these approaches, they are seen by many as confirming them. Okay, so what we're seeing in the course of our work as a project is that the realities of the region often serve to to enforce some of the theories and approaches that exist from outside. So we see things like the division of the world into strong and weak states, you know, these dichotomies that continue to exist. What is critical security studies? This is my awkward transition to the next part. As one would expect, we would hope that a critical approach to security studies would help us overcome some of these many barriers, not just academically, but also socially and institutionally as well. Okay, so these are the barriers that I've laid out. We would hope that a critical security studies would help us overcome this. Of course, I should begin by defining what I think of as critical security studies and how it differs from, say, like normal security studies. What do the existing schools of critical security studies look like? Of course, I could give a whole lecture on what critical security studies is, but I want to just state very briefly that critical approaches begin from the assumption that security is not a fixed value, that it changes over time and between contexts. Security is a contested concept, and threats, risks, and appropriate responses are always debated and debatable. In short, a gun is a gun, but a gun is not always a threat. A refugee is a refugee, but not all refugees are risks, okay? So the critical security studies tries to interrogate the process through which these things become risks and threats and acted upon accordingly. So from these assumptions, critical security studies attempts to adopt a much wider perspective of security that moves us beyond the state. So if you think of a game of Risk, Risk is always played the same way. You always have the same sources of insecurity in the game of Risk. It's always states that have more Okay, so what critical security studies is saying is that no, we have to move beyond this. We have to think in a wider way about security, and we have to see security as changing over time. So one way to think about this is that security and insecurity is not some objective condition that exists throughout time in the same way, but that it is produced through a series of acts, such as the way we talk about people or communities and the ways in which we act upon them. So one interesting thing, before I live in the United States, I was like looking at Twitter. Yesterday was July 4th. Twitter and my Facebook is all weird because of the timing, and people talking about, you know, what's happened to the United States. You know, it's this country of refugees and it's become this. I don't want to engage in those debates, but it's an interesting way in which the origin story of the United States for many people is tied up with this like positive views of immigration and people fleeing violence and persecution, and now there's this radical turn away from that. And I use that example parenthetically just to demonstrate what I'm talking about here, that sometimes migrants are not seen as threats. Sometimes migrants get incorporated into the origin stories of nations, okay? So the process through which this happens is not objective. Threats are not objective. They are produced and created. So the goal of a critical security studies project is to begin from the assumption that security is a subjective, not an objective condition, and to unravel that. Based on this, we can identify six methodological schools in critical security studies. There's a normative school that is focused on human security. Maybe many of you have heard of that concept. This is associated with the Welsh school or Aberystwyth. There's a sociological a school that's based on the work of Pierre Bourdieu, the Paris school, that's focused on sociological explanations of security policies, so like looking at institutions and bureaucrats. There's a discursive school that is referred to as the Copenhagen school that focuses on the process of securitization and desecuritization, so how something gets articulated, spoken about as threat, and how it gets gets articulated as a security threat, and then kind of desecuritized. So what are those processes? There's a feminist school that broadly focuses on the gender dynamics of security. A school that, based on the work of Bruno Latour, that focuses on the interactions between humans and material objects within security politics. And finally, a post-structuralist school that is more closely indebted to Michel Foucault, that focuses on the construction of national identity and foreign policies. So these are broadly what we might define as six schools. I've done so in a paragraph, so bear with me here. I've tried to do my best to introduce that. So this is the general academic context in which the Beirut School was conceived. If you notice from my brief list of the security schools, one thing should stand out. They're predominantly based out of European institutions, thinkers, concepts, academics, and so on. What does this mean for scholars who work in and on the Arab region? Rather than approaching the question of how to advance critical security studies in the Arab region as an empirical one, that is to say, we should find ways to encourage Arab researchers to write within these traditions, we started from a different premise. And that premise was that it was entirely possible and likely that a critical research agenda for the region, grounded in the work of scholars working in and on the region, would yield more dynamic, interesting, and analytically relevant insights into questions of security and insecurity in the region. And I want to emphasize this point as being very important. On the one hand, we can look at the work of these schools and see an empirical gap. That is, there is not a lot of work from scholars in the region or from people writing about the region that fits within these schools. So when we were writing this grant to get to become this working group, this collective, we said we don't want to do just that. We want to try something different. Okay, so we don't want to just get 20 people writing in international political sociology or security or whatever. That we wanted to try and rethink what it means to be what it means to do critical security studies research. So beginning from that premise, we started our project inspired by three main questions that informed the writing of a collectively authored piece that lays out our vision for a Beirut School of Critical Security Studies. I'm happy to send it to anybody if you tell me after. The three questions, very simple ones. What are we seeing as researchers? Second, what are the limitations of the current approaches to the study of security and insecurity? Finally, what can an alternative approach to the study of security and insecurity look like? It's these three questions that inform the writing of the manifesto that I'm happy to share. So the collective began with these questions and was, not populated, but the people who formed the collective were Arab and non-Arab scholars based in Beirut, as well as Arab and non-Arab scholars who have worked on questions of security in Lebanon. What all of us had in common were the encounters with the lived experiences of insecurity and precarity in Lebanon, the complex dynamics of contentious politics within a pluralistic environment, and an interest in engaging scholarly knowledge production across and between North American, European, and Arab institutions. From this core, the project expanded to include scholars from or working across the region with similar concerns. So it was very much grounded in Beirut and people working on Lebanon, and now we're slowly growing, if you will. What we want to avoid and want to counter as a network is the proliferation of security studies and strategic studies training programs and think tanks that are developing across the region. So if you look at what's happening, especially in the Gulf, certainly in Egypt, you have these military-focused, military-centered, strategic-studies-centered think tanks that are emerging, where the study of security is done in militaristic, state-centric ways. And this is one of the contexts in which we've conceived of this. most popular conceptions of the Middle East and North Africa, but especially the Middle East, if we're going to draw these divisions, are that it is a security problem and that the region is to be analyzed and acted upon as such. Such thinking has permeated Western approaches to the region, especially, although not exclusively, after 9/11, and has subjected the peoples and environments of the region to an unending series of wars, occupations, sanctions, and other forms of intervention. At the same time, it goes without saying that many domestic regimes have been a major source of insecurity for their own populations. All of these factors have seriously compromised the ability of researchers, political actors, and others to articulate how insecurity is experienced, and in turn to promote alternative forms of collective security. While we as a collective reject any pretense towards speaking for the entire region, we believe in the need for new knowledge and theories of security to be constituted by the people living, working, and researching in the region, who are intimately familiar with the ways in which security and insecurity are produced. In this way, we are motivated and inspired by a suggestion from one of our members, Waleed Hasbun, that the future of critical security studies may actually be in the creation of national schools that link researchers together to explore issues of insecurity in their own countries or in their own regions. So what brings us together, what brought us together, still, I suppose, unites, that brings us together, is this belief that the insecurity conundrum that peoples of the region experience is ill understood with reference to the long-held analytical frameworks within mainstream approaches to the study of security. So to be more direct, what we see is a misfit between the ways in which theories and people write about and think about questions of security and insecurity in the region and what we're seeing as researchers. Okay? So there's an incompatibility almost with the tools that we're given in our academic context to understand what we're trying to understand. So if we think of frameworks that are solutions oriented, you know, how can we do intervention better? How can we do war better? These sorts of things. That type of scholarship does not tell us anything about the ways in which individuals experience insecurity. Okay, these are solutions oriented, policy oriented. Okay? And what this research does and what we are trying to counter is completely ignore the ways in which these actions impact peoples, states, societies, authorities, and so on. In other words, this scholarship does not reflect the co-constitution of global politics, that is the way in which global politics is should be thought of in inclusionary ways, not exclusionary ways. Okay? So approaches to security which privilege the experiences, anxieties, and insecurities of the West, and which deny the multiple experiences of the non-West, encourage us to think of the world in terms of dichotomies, whether they're sovereign, economic, or racial. This manifests in the research, think tanks, university programs that are all state and military centered, and which advance very narrow interests, narrow understandings of security. Thus, the global experiences that have, for us, been central to shaping the region, particularly imperialism and colonialism, remain under-theorized in the broader literature on security. So in the spirit of post-colonial approaches to global politics, we hope to advance what Edward Said called this contrapuntal analysis of global politics that accounts for the co-constitution of experience and not their separation. So that is, rather than studying intervention as a problem that needs to be, you know, we need to do intervention better, try to understand how interventions generate insecurity for people and communities. So in trying to adopt this approach, we want to highlight the multiple and new forms of securitization that are emerging in the region. The basic premise of the project then, and what we see absent from most traditional and critical approaches to security, is that the sources of insecurity in the region are proliferating in new and complicated ways. And while this is happening, there are emerging new sites of resistance and social movements that are attempting to counter and reverse the patterns of war, occupation, sectarianism, of course, from all of us who work on Lebanon, this is a big issue, and environmental destruction. So ultimately, what we're calling for is the proliferation of approaches that localize our understandings of security and insecurity in the region, that help us capture and understand these patterns. To do so, we have not structured our research agenda around key issues or themes that are understudied, or which advance a particular notion of security. Instead, we have developed three frameworks of inquiry as guides, reflecting the inter and multidisciplinary interests and methodologies that all of us bring to the project. So rather than ascribing a particular approach, we propose the following three frameworks. The first is an engagement with approaches found within existing critical security studies scholarship. We're advocating for and calling for more nuanced application of these approaches and for more regionally situated research. This is not throwing the baby out with the bathwater. We don't think that those six schools that I identified earlier are useless or pointless or whatever. We think they have a lot to offer us, and we do need to be thinking about what it is that they offer us, okay? The second is what we are calling an Arab critical security studies or an Arab security studies that is grounded in Arab political and critical thought. Here, we are committed to developing theoretical positions on security in the region that draw on work from outside of the Western canon. We are also interested in encouraging research that maps existing archives, memories, and vocabularies that trace the evolution of regional thinkers and theories. Finally, we are calling for a project centered on the development of new pedagogical practices and collaborative research questions that represent a radical openness to the ways in which critical security studies can be done. And this is why the manifesto, for example, was produced collaboratively. So we're trying to think about how we can kind of teach and write and do research in these spaces. Today, many academic fields advocate for the inclusion of voices from the global south. We hope that what we're doing is creating the conditions for such inclusion and engagement, but in ways that support collaboration and not tutelage. What Zainab and I were talking about yesterday was, you know, the ways in which many of these things are very colonial. Many collaborations are colonial, and we really want to ensure that what we're doing is collaborative and not reproducing inequalities. So what have we done? That's saying all these fun things, and it's great. What does the project look like? We have an annual summer institute that is for graduate students and early career faculty. That just finished a few weeks ago in Beirut. It's an amazing experience. So we come together for 6 days. We've had two of them so far. We've just had a commitment for the next 2 years, 3 years maybe, to have them, to continue funding them. We have a major grants and research mentoring program. So people can apply to do research, and people from within the collective offer mentorship and partnership to support this. We've held multiple workshops, almost all of which are within the region. We had one outside of the region, and that was only because a number of us happened to be in Boston at the time. But all of our work occurs, all of these workshops occur in the region. And one of the things that we're doing now, we're developing the curriculum around these 2 day workshops, 1 to 2 day workshops, where we want to go to different universities in the region and engage with scholars and students around issues of doing criticality, and not just to come parachute in and pontificate, but to begin to establish these forms of collaboration and in ways that can socially reproduce the collective, so that in 10 years, I'm not the one giving this same talk, that I've retired from this, hopefully. So what we want to do through this network building is to advance knowledge production from the region, as well as to establish linkages between the region, the diaspora — of course I'm in the diaspora — and other academic institutions around the world. So we're not trying to simply produce a more accurate representation. I want to make that clear. We don't think that there's some sort of thing, diamond out there, that we have to find it. There's this accurate, wonderful representation. But we want to highlight the theories, approaches, and histories that should be incorporated into the study of security. This is what we're ultimately trying to do. And to do so, we want to hold up a mirror to the US and European approaches to the study of security in order to highlight, in the best tradition of criticality and critical security studies, how these policies generate insecurity for communities across the Arab region that generally feed back into US and Western anxieties and fears. So what I've done is discuss the, up to now, the basic premise, goal, trajectory of the Beirut School. I've mapped out the background and foundation, the creation and the content, basically, of the manifesto, and what we see as our role in creating knowledge about security and insecurity in the Arab region, although it's been brief. I now want to take up the question of what makes us a school. Something that's really interesting is that if you look at all the schools of critical security studies, they weren't so narcissistic as us to call themselves a school. They just did this research and people called them a school. And so we are really arrogant in calling ourselves a school. So what makes us a school? What is the basis of this claim that we are trying to make about our work? If you recall from the beginning of my presentation, I suggested that the division of critical security studies schools was based primarily on methodological positions. You may have also noticed throughout the course of my presentation that I have not at one point suggested that the Beirut School seeks to either replicate any of these schools or to adopt a particular methodological approach to the study of security and insecurity. Indeed, as far as methodology goes, we are deeply committed to pluralism. The question remains then, why are we calling ourselves a school? If all these other schools are distinguished by their methodologies, then what is our claim to this? On this question, on the question of what constitutes an academic school, I'd like to refer to an article written by two friends of mine, colleagues, Mark Salter and Miguel de Larrañaga, who both at the University of Ottawa, in a widely read and widely criticized article, attempted to map out what they called a Canadian approach to critical security studies. Their argument was based on existing scholarship by scholars based at Canadian institutions. So what they did is they basically read everything they could that was produced out of Canadian institutions. And what they found was that criticality, critical security studies, was clustering around particular institutions, such as the University of Ottawa, McMaster University, and that particular themes were also found within these clusters. And that these themes were of national concern, such as the continued impact of settler state colonialism, indigenous politics in Canada, and environmental security threats. So what their argument entailed was not the creation of a school around a particular methodology, but around sociological and institutional poles that were linked through the focus of particular themes of research. The argument was essentially this. If we survey the knowledge production from Canadian institutions, what we find are two things. Critical scholars tend to cluster around particular institutions, and they tend to produce similarly themed research. Okay, does that make sense? Yeah. So they called this a kind of Canadian school, okay? And they were criticized for it. And the main criticism was that they were creating a school and an identity out of nothing. That basically what you just had was a national university system. That when there were some people who did critical work and some people who didn't. More importantly, the criticism was that, or another part of the criticism was that there was the failure to articulate a common methodological, conceptual, or theoretical position of the school, even if they had common empirical concerns. Okay, so the lack of this kind of, say, securitization or a Latourian approach to whatever, you know, that meant that you couldn't call yourself a school. Well, what I'd like to suggest is that actually a sociological or an institutional approach to the creation of a school, or to the constitution of a school, especially from scratch as we are trying to do, can help us overcome many of the existing challenges that I identified at the beginning of the presentation. In particular, the construction of a school centered institutionally around the Arab Council for the Social Sciences, and sociologically and professionally diffused through institutions in the Arab world, provides the space for the articulation of plural, diverse, and dynamic methods and approaches to the study of insecurity. The school we seek to create is thus not restricted to methodological consistency, but to empirical, conceptual, and theoretical diversity that reflects the vast experiences of researchers working in and on the region. So what brings us together as a school is a commitment to criticality on the one hand, and an emphasis on the conditions that produce insecurity for the peoples and states in the region. By turning security studies around to ask what produces insecurity, and not simply what produces security, we hope to advance more dynamic scholarship on what makes peoples and states insecure in the region. So why does this matter? Why should people, what's the importance of this to North Africa? I'm taking up this question because Zainab suggested it, because I think it's a really good one. So this is my reflection, so I apologize if it reads as a, if it appears as a reflection. Zainab said to me something in Beirut that really stuck with me, and I wish I could have changed the name of the title. She said, we have this program, but we don't call it MENA, Middle East and North Africa, we call it NAME. I thought, wow. You're displacing the Middle East all of a sudden. But I thought if I could rename this talk, I would call it What's in a Name? And what does it mean to privilege something like the Middle East? And what does it mean to have a scholarly research project in which all of the scholars basically work on the Middle East? Right? So I do think that a methodologically plural and sociologically diffused approach to the study of insecurity means that we are naturally inclusive to scholarship from the region broadly defined. But what that means is that through the creation of the school and our practices, we need to think about how to actually create that co-constitution that I was referring to earlier. So one of the things that I want to talk about and reflect on here is this massive misfit between the faculty at our Summer Institute. I'm using the Summer Institute as an example. The faculty at our Summer Institute, which are overwhelmingly male, who work on Syria and Lebanon, and the students, who are overwhelmingly from North African institutions. Okay, so we have the researchers and students who are most active in applying to our projects and to our workshops and to our panels are North Africans, which is really interesting, isn't it? but yet, I'm not entirely convinced that their research interests are expressed in the way that we are talking about and working on the project. So the challenge for us is how to create these institutional linkages and how to reproduce the project in ways that reflects that geographic diversity and which brings in those empirical concerns so that the project is not simply saying, well, this is how we study things in Lebanon and this is how we study things in Egypt, but to do what we are committed to doing, which is to create an approach that allows for these kind of co-constituted politics. Okay, so one of the other dilemmas that I think we face is that we have never had people. If you can imagine this, we've not had one person from Lebanon or Gulf universities ever apply for our grants or our summer institutes or anything like that. So for us, geographically speaking, the challenge is not simply to find ways to bring in more North African scholarship, but to also think about how to incorporate scholars from the Gulf. One of my favorite, and the reason I think that this is so important is not just because it is, but one of my favorite moments from this year's summer institute was when an Algerian student told a Lebanese faculty instructor that he should be reading a Syrian theorist that died 100 years ago. And I thought this was this wonderful moment that captured what we're trying to do, to speak with each other, to share ideas, and to get out of our geographic and, of course, methodological bubbles. So these cross-geographic conversations are needed and necessary to make the Beirut School more dynamic and reflective and inclusive of the scholarly concerns of North African researchers. But more importantly, I think that a shift towards North African scholars and scholarship can provide much deeper historical and geographic context to the issues of war, occupation, and intervention that many of us are concerned with. Rather than separating the Middle East and North Africa, or North Africa and the Middle East, as it's called here, a more horizontal integration of scholars can allow us to think creatively and constructively about how patterns of insecurity in Morocco, for example, are related to those in Iraq and Lebanon. Maybe they are, maybe they are. It is through these forms of horizontal conversation that I think we can begin to fulfill the goal of the Beirut School and to provide a truly Arab critical security studies. And with that, I will end and leave it for questions. Thank you.
But the workshops that you want to do at local universities in the region, have you already done those, or is that a plan? And if you have done them, I'd be really interested to hear about the reception of that.
Yeah.
Do you have people who think you are just parachuting in to do something, or is there a good, is there a good vibe when you're there?
Do you want me to collect questions, or do you want me to answer them as I go? That's a great one.
Because,
do you want me to collect a couple? Or
we just go.
Okay, so the first workshop was supposed to be here in Morocco. It was supposed to happen like last month. So I took on responsibility with a Moroccan colleague who's at Hammatzenk to develop curriculum around this. And the idea was, and we agreed as a collective, that we would design a kind of one day curriculum. Right, and the second day, whoever is presenting that material could read their own work with the students or have student or whatever. So you would have some flexibility, and so my colleague and I were supposed to do this, and there was some miscommunication with the ACSS about funding, and when they realized why it broke down after, they said, "Oh my God, we really want to support this, so we're going to support it in the future." So we will have one in Morocco in the next, hopefully 12 months in the next year. But interesting, so the reason I'm talking about all this, I insisted that the workshop happen in Arabic, even though I do not function academically in Arabic. So, we talk after, I could not give this presentation in Arabic. My colleague insisted that it take place in English, even though he functions academically in Arabic, and he writes in Arabic. So we had this very interesting fight, basically, that, so for all the other things that we were worried about, funding and hotels and bringing people on application, whatever, this thing we couldn't get over. So here was this, guy from Philadelphia insisting that this take place in Arabic or that we have translation. And he was saying, no, my colleague, we need to function in English. So, for me it was very interesting. And he was insisting on this. So to answer your question, we have not had one of those yet because we had this funding issue. We have now received funding for it. The first one is going to be in Algeria. And the second one is likely to be in Tunisia. I mean, this partly reflects what I was trying to talk about at the end. Let's be honest, there are only certain places we can do this. And those happen to be two of them where we feel comfortable. The ACSS has like a field office in Algeria that can coordinate it, and I'm hoping that the third one can be, if not here, then somewhere. So it's something that we are hyper aware of, and one of the, so maybe to link that to the Summer Institute thing, if you want to know a fun exercise, try to do a critical security studies Summer Institute for people who only read in Arabic. It's impossible. There's no material. We had a lot of difficulty finding material in Arabic. And so what ends up happening, what we did at the first Summer Institute was we had a lot of material in English, and it was just, I mean, it was tough for me to get through some of it. And so this year we brought it down, and we found that a lot of students still weren't able to do it. So they had difficulty kind of getting through the material, which is completely normal when it's your third language. I mean, I can't read this stuff academically. And so it's something, it's a big problem. And one of the ways actually that we're trying to overcome it, so I'm reflecting on this to say that we're taking it very seriously. So in our rule for our website, now that it's live, is that everything gets translated into Arabic, but not everything gets translated into Arabic or English or French. So if something is submitted into Arabic, it stays in Arabic, okay? And because that's who we're trying to reach, Arabic speakers. Another thing that we're trying to do now, and I'm advocating for, is for us to be writing 6 to 8 page papers that inform these workshops. So instead of coming in and saying, read Foucault, read, you know, which is tough for, I meant function in English, and it's tough. So we have a primer on the security studies schools that was written by a colleague that was translated into Arabic. Our manifesto is translated into Arabic, so that's where we're trying to go with the material, is to make sure that it's always accessible in Arabic. And right now, my colleague and I, who we're co-coordinating the project, we're trying to produce a reader, and we're negotiating with the publisher for the Arabic rights. And so it will be translated into Arabic, and we're hoping that can be the basis of the workshops, and that can be done, like we can do whatever we want with that electronically, and that will hopefully be the basis. So I assume that we will run into these things. One of the problems we have is at the Summer Institute. There are lots of, nobody ever says, you know, why are you speaking English or why, but there are very interesting power dynamics that play out. Especially in Beirut, yeah. And there are language, there are some language politics that happen. And I have to say, with all honesty, that most of us are just embracing it and recognizing that it's part of what we're doing, and we all recognize our limitations. And so, yeah. But the Summer Institute, we haven't been told we're colonial. Like, if that makes sense. I mean, it's almost always in Arabic and English, and I think people just assume they're going to function. So, like, our joke is that I do all the English stuff and Ahmad does all the Arabic stuff. That's our kind of division of the linguistic division of labor. But, yeah, we're trying, yeah. Thank you so much. So I promised Zena earlier that I would give some empirical examples of things, and I didn't, because I just got excited. And when I noticed people weren't dozing off, I thought, maybe I'll just keep going. So I'll give a couple of them now. So one of our basic assumptions is that people don't study insecurity. Right? It's like, so even critical scholarship is focused on okay, so why do we have all these CCTV cameras, and you know, how is global capital implicated in this stuff? It rarely asks, how do the people receive this, right? And so if you talk to an anthropologist, and if you talk to like the kind of human security folks, they might say, well, development, I mean, that's where the whole paradigm came from, right? So people are poor and they're insecure, okay? Well, but if you talk to the anthropologist, they would tell you, well, anxiety is insecurity, fear of war is insecurity, you know, all these other conditions of insecurity. So what we're trying to do is to say, maybe that's the thing that we should study, right? Is not not be critical about you know, how global capital is implicated in increasing surveillance, but to say, like, this is how people navigate these terrains, and this is how they experience insecurity. So right now I'm working on a special issue called Intervention as Insecurity, and looking at non-military intervention, actually, so looking at NGO work, these things as forms of intervention that seek to reconfigure state and society in particular ways. So if you think of, like, Susan Woodward's argument, the ideology of failed state, she says, you know, they come up with this idea that states are failing, right? And they go in and, you know, they like, through their policies, contribute to the state's failure, right? And this is the argument that I made with Ben in our security dialogue article, that when that was on the Special Tribunal for Lebanon, and the argument that we made there was that the West was claiming, I mean, the tribunal, right? So whoever is behind the tribunal, let's leave that to another day, but the UN, as it advocates for the tribunal, in the name of the lack of Lebanese sovereignty. It says we need to intervene as a judicial body to prosecute the crime of murder. It's the first time that the crime of murder was prosecuted internationally. We need to intervene because the state is not sovereign. But in the process of intervening, it undermines the sovereignty of the state itself. And that's what we're trying to do, I think. If that speaks a bit to the human security agenda, I think another concern with the human security agenda is that it's been kind of co-opted, I think, in many ways into the security development paradigm, right? That and the security development nexus, I mean, of course, security and development have always been linked, of course, but the way it emerges in the kind of post-Cold War era is to suggest that an individual's security is somehow related to global security. So if you secure the individual, then you secure the global. And that's a great idea, but the problem is that it's produced all sorts of interventions, development and security and otherwise, that undermine the security of the communities that they're trying to help. So one of the things that I will say about the concept of insecurity and the complexity of it is how many of the researchers that we're engaging with within the project often replicate that language of human security and the security development nexus, even though they think they're writing critically. What they're doing often is, I would sort of say, like, being oppositional, if that makes sense. The example that I gave Zainab earlier, and I'll say to everybody here, is we had a somebody from Tunisia come and wrote this paper to come to the Summer Institute. And we admitted this person in the Summer Institute, and the paper read like a UNDP document. People at the border experience insecurity this way, this is what they do, blah, 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 blah. And I said to her, we have these like groups where we all sit together and interrogate the work that people submit. So I said to her, like, I don't know the difference between this and a UNDP document. And she said, well, and she just went on about all this stuff that she had seen at the border in her 9 months of fieldwork, the role of women, the smuggling, the, like, this fascinating world in which people and the state interact at the border in very unique ways. That wasn't in the proposal. And Partly because she said to us, she didn't have the language to express that, and she thought that that's the way in which she should be writing to publish. So she was betraying her own fieldwork, her own eyes, her own perspective, because she thought that that's how you get into summer institutes, that's how you get published, that you see, like, I see this room, and I go back and I say, well, it was full of, you know, the room was full of other, like, even though I saw that the room is full of you guys, I go back and I say something else. And that, I think, is one of the challenges we have in thinking about insecurity in complex ways, is that we are using other language. So it's definitely a challenge for us. So the focus on the Arab world, you know, our funding source is the Arab Council, so we have to use it. We have had so many fights and so many debates about the use of the term Arab in this project that it is both like the most meaningful thing and the most meaningless thing in the world. I mean, let's be honest, what does it mean to talk about an Arab researcher in a context where many people are displaced? I mean, how many refugees do you have? Not just from that, I mean, my family left after the 67 war. Before that, my uncles left after the collapse of the Ottoman Empire. You know, I mean, there's all these conditions that have produced a diaspora, okay? And that's not to defend my participation in the project, but to say that to speak of Arab researchers is not exclusive to, I think, the Arab world. And it's the definition that the Arab Council has. So an Arab researcher is anybody with Arab citizenship or Arab heritage who is a researcher. So you could be in Australia, you know, you could be in South Africa, you could be anywhere. Which is why I qualify as somebody who can apply for this type of funding and whatever, because I have citizenship, even though I live outside. And then there are, of course, other questions of security. You know, what can people do and not do? So. I believe that our goal from the very beginning was to move beyond the focus. Oh, the other thing, sorry, I want to say was that Arab world has been expanded to mean anywhere where there are Arabs. Okay, so it's this very loose definition of who gets to participate and what geographies are included. So a project on Syrians in Turkey qualifies for funding in the council, I believe. We have one in our interventions project. The reason I'm giving that example is that we have one of those projects in our interventions as insecurity. And that's sort of like, okay, that fits. We also have another one that looks at the development of humanitarian practices in Syrian refugee camps and its imports into East African refugee camps. And that kind of qualifies, if you will. So we have this very expansive definition of what it means. I believe that I'm speaking for everybody involved in the project so far that we don't want to restrict the project to this kind of nationalism, that we definitely do see it as something that hopefully contributes to a larger kind of project of the Global South. And to that end, one of the things that we're trying to do is to apply for this funding across institutions. So the problem for us right now is the ACSS has a mandate to produce research in and for the region. But if we're able to link up with other institutions, so we're actually considering now some equivalents in Latin America. So what can we do to bring scholars together to explore these questions? And so to de-Arabize the Arab project, if that makes sense. So we are painfully aware that we are speaking in exceptional terms by calling it this. And at the beginning, it was purely a function of the funding. And now we're trying to grow and move beyond it. But yes, thank you for pointing that out. Meaning of life. Anything else?
I guess if you have more questions about the forum, the Arab Council for Students and Answers,
Yeah.